cosplayers in the audience? Any Mad Max cosplayers here?
So
we can see things pushing forward, and also you have like things like Mad Max obviously still having like the same boots. He has the tattoo that says Rogue Warrior, same shotgun, all that stuff. So I guess my next question is, knowing that this is a revisit, how do we approach Max as a character in Fury Road? Is he the same guy?
To Ricci thing, like he is not the blind bandit, but he's the guy who wanders with the fucked up leg. But whether it's the same guy with the leg in every movie isn't essential. It's that it's sort of, you know, it's the folk hero.
Right.
Or it's different talent. You know, the thing is, like, every movie could be somebody's story that they're just relaying, and it, I think like three of the movies there's voice.
It's very explicit too in Beyond Thunderdome with the, it is a retelling at the end. You've been hearing a story about Mad Max. I like to think of him as sort of a Western hero, like the man with no name. He's rolling into town and he's not, I know like a focus for Fury Road was that it's not Max's story, but really he's always coming and interrupting other people's stories. Like, he comes in and he's not really the perpetuator of the action, but he comes in to sort of help and then fade off into the distance, like your wandering folk hero.
Did you have a question? I just wanted to say that I kind of view it in a similar way as
I've heard.
Oh, are you going somewhere with that? Like the feral kid?
Feral. adopted the mantle, the Mad Max.
The Falcon also has his own continuity at the end of Road Warrior, where you're supposed to know what happens to him.
And that actually,
he gets less girl.
That always really annoyed me, because I really wanted him to stay, like, an adult and just, like, crunch at people. So I kind of really, like, I really like the...
He's Chaka.
Yeah, because, I mean, that, like, adult Mad Max can still crunch and be incoherent and still, you know, lead his people, as we see in Three Roads, so...
Also, he doesn't know how to use a boomerang. I think that's... Right, like, wouldn't he still know how to use a boomerang?
He graduates to the shotgun.
I think that it is the same that he is Mel Gibson, because as I said, they're all kind of retellings from other people's voiceovers. So it would be kind of like how different people view them. Some people would remember some things and describe them one way, some people would remember other things. But the essentials, like the jacket and the brace, wouldn't change.
Yeah, I think when you look at the end of Beyond the Thunderdome and the waiting ones are kind of going through a retelling of the story, you kind of treat it. Before it is sort of, you know, the game of telephone, whereas generations upon generations are going, it's a retelling of that same character, but there will be nuanced changes where someone new to the story can still enjoy it, but then someone who's listened to the other version of the story can find those little threads that connect everything together.
And I think that actually plays into, kind of stylistically, the films get increasingly, I would call them like rococo as they go on. Like, it's only slightly apocalyptic in the first film, and then it just gets sort of fancier and more world building and more production design and more kind of bonkers in a really appealing way. And I know that when they were scouting for locations for all the desert scenes in Fury Road, George Miller said, "I don't want to see a blade of grass." And there's actually like plenty of grass in the first film. There's parks and the beach and houses and...
I think that kind of is where a lot of the disconnect over whether or not he's supposed to be like the literal continuing adventures of Mad Max as played by Mel Gibson, like that specific character, because you have such a long seemingly stretch of time as like the environment continues to degrade, like maybe he's immortal. Could he have survived through that long for society to sort of break down and then rebuild itself in his work Jones' name, you know?
And it also makes you wonder, too, if you know, you don't have somebody that learns Max's story and takes on the mantle of his name and tries to be what he was in the past for that folk hero. So it's, you know, a character, you know, War Boy or Warbuck, as the generations go on, taking on that mantle.
Right, and just along the same lines, that could mean you have various societies who grow up hearing stories about Max and various people in different places trying to take up the mantle of Max, so there could be multiple Maxes running around different areas just because that's part of folk culture and trying to be what you hear.
Yes?
To add on to, like, Max, like, having a long lifespan, if you think about it, from the first one where there is still societal structure and everything, you go all the way to the Thunderdome where he meets, like, all the wild children, he still remembers what airplanes are, what society was, and everything. Those kids are pretty old. They've never seen any of this. They've learned everything from their parents. So it's kind of like, maybe he has survived this
long. But there's also a fan theory that I've only heard, like, I think it was on the Reddit somewhere, and it really struck me because, like, if you go with Mad Max as a real kid and, like, you can position Fury Road before Thunderdome, and there's a theory that I read that, like, because Auntie Entity, George Miller has said that her backstory actually follows the Candelian hero myth, even though she shows up as a sort of anti-hero in Thunderdome, like to get to the position where she would be in a position to rebuild Bartertown, she would have had to go through her own heroic arc. And the theory that I saw was maybe Charlize Theron, like maybe Furiosa is Auntie Entity, like if you can wrap your brain around that, like that twist, like. And the reason that she lets Max go at the end of Thunderdome is because they have this backstory, and it's not just, oh, I saw you do this stuff around, like, while you were off, you know, ruining my town and fleeing from me. It's that they have this history together, and she knows and respects him because they built this thing together. Because obviously we see Furiosa go on a hero, you know, myth of her own. And I like that too, because it also really puts you in a position to get into the aesthetics of Thunderdome.
I was just going to say, I think it's really interesting that we've been talking about Max as a hero, because for me, like, I think of him as like a folk hero in the sense that he's a character in a lot of stories, but not really an archetypal hero. He really never is super into helping people. He's really disgruntled about it. It's mostly like he's heroic in the sense that he survives, and all of his skills are survival skills, not necessarily there to really uplift people. God, he hates those kids.
Those kids are annoying.
Yeah, so like I never really thought of him as like a traditional.
Yeah, I think his
like
power is how he comes in and changes other people, and using sort of, you know, Western storytelling, that would make them the protagonist and him the mentor.
Right, yeah.
Right, he's kind of the one who sets the wheels going and gets things on the right direction without realizing or without even really wanting to, but that's just kind of his stock character.
He always has that moment when he can turn away and, you know, let them wander off to the desert, let them go get killed. And he always says, no, come back, I'll fix this. And so,
sometimes you can tell he's deliberating about it. It's like, well, if you want to, you know, go across the salt flats and see if there's anything, then okay. But then he deliberates, has a change of heart, and pitches his two cents in. And if they take it, they take it. If they don't, they don't. But that's still his influence.
Yes.
That's why I like Capable as a wife. She does the same thing Max does, but for Nux, in the sense that, you know, she's trying to change him and his point of view and his mindset to where he ended up again.
Yeah, he also does get pulled into the society, like, as he goes along. The structure of the film is always that he comes to connect in some way with the community that he's helping.
The moment where he gives Furiosa his blood, I think, is that moment of intimacy between them, and the fact that he bothers to tell her his name. But it takes him the whole film, and he's like, well, if she's going to die, I might as well tell her my name before she dies.
I think also maybe those moments where he deliberates before helping, like with the kids in Thunderdome or with telling the Mugolini not to go across the salt flats, I think sometimes he takes his psychological profile into account and goes, you know what, if I say nothing, I'll feel guilty about it, and then I'll have even more post-traumatic stress than I already do. So at least I can give them my advice, and if they take it, they take it. If they don't, they don't, but at least, you know, I will be absolved, and I don't have it on my conscience if something terrible happens to them.
How do you guys do over there, by the way? You guys good? Any questions? Yes?
They think that
he is somebody else because they've already, like, they see this white guy lying in the desert and they're like, oh, if you're this guy alone in the desert, you must be our chosen one.
And I think, interestingly, the kids are also saved at the end by an aviator. So in a certain way, he's also Captain Walker, in addition to being the gyro captain and Jedediah.
So I wanted to talk a little bit about aesthetic, because we've gotten into it a little bit. Like, the diesel, the geomazing dome that's used for Thunderdome and the wives' like prison vault. They're literally locked inside a vault. George Miller is not like subtle. I always thought it was really interesting because the geodesic dome was not invented by Buckminster Fuller, but it was sort of popularized by Buckminster Fuller, who's like this inventor design philosopher of the 20th century, and he influenced a lot of like late 20th century design elements. And his thing was always that design should lead us to a better, more harmonized, synthesized society. And he thought that like just elegant design and aesthetic was the way to get to like self-fulfillment and empowerment and like just humanitarian utopia. And I always thought it was super interesting that George Miller specifically took one of his most, like Buckminster Fuller's most famous design, basically, the geodesic dome, and used it for this like completely brutal like deconstruction of like post-apocalyptic like lack of humanity, almost nihilism, like the complete opposite of what Fuller was going for. And I wondered if you guys wanted to talk a bit about that kind of aesthetic breakdown and how he uses it to deconstruct the world.
I was going to say the Room of the Wives, it's like a cultural place of learning, so he's sort of flipping it back around. Even though they're kept as slaves, they also have books, which must be like huge in terms of cultural currency. From, I mean, I guess people are literate since this tattoo or his words, but I can't imagine there's a printing press anywhere and anymore shows like waterfall tower.
Like someone giving them piano lessons.
Right, yeah. So going from Thunderdome, where people are like gonna kill each other, to this sort of haven, even though it's obviously set up as like a false haven for them, but like it's like the last bastions of like that kind of artistic society.
And I mean, the way they transfer knowledge is they have a history people who tattoo themselves with whatever knowledge they can get their hands on, and they have these shorthand notes literally that they wear on their bodies as kind of reminders of what they already know and what they can pass on to other people. So, yeah, probably no printing press.
Right, and the children are all just chanting, repeating things in unison so they can all memorize their own history. So I think that's an interesting thing on the geodesic dome. If you wanted to talk more about aesthetics.
Generally of the films.
Right, I liked, we were talking about this earlier, the sort of origin of the Mad Max aesthetic, how he came to that, and then literally all the other things that were influenced by that exact aesthetic.
Yeah, I mean, I think the movie came out in 1979, which is like right in the heart of the punk music scene, which was actually only a couple years that it really existed, technically, before all those bands broke up. And the 70s was a gas and oil crisis, and it was worldwide. I don't think it's a coincidence. I think
he said specifically that he was influenced by the Australian gas crisis.
Yeah. So that would have been it would have been a prescient film and very much on his mind, like literally right now, oh shit, this is going to happen next year. I think there's obviously like, in addition to like the punk music influences, there's S&M bondage gear.
Yeah, can we talk about a little bit of how Road Warrior is basically like punk versus glam rock? Like, like when Adam Lambert first started appearing on American Idol, like I just kept thinking, oh my god, he looks so familiar. And finally I realized that he looked exactly like Wiz. Like exactly, like they had like the same like shoulder pads with like the fluffy like things and like the same mohawk, and it's like, holy crap, Adam Lambert is Wiz from Road Warrior. And that just like really like struck me, because obviously there's a whole lot of like glam rock.
And people were very anti, a lot of people were very anti-glam rock and anti-disco, and people that fell down on kind of the rock and the punk side had serious feelings about a lot of that. And obviously there were bands that were kind of overlapped between the two, but...
Yes?
Does
that make Fury Road, like, punk versus heavy metal? So it's like Doof Warrior with this metal car?
Doof is definitely still part of a punk aesthetic. He reminded me of like very new metal, kind of like 90s like rap metal. I think this gets us
into literal diesel punk too, because diesel punk is all about metal. The aesthetic of diesel punk is all about metal. There was apparently a Fury Road panel earlier in the diesel punk, the alternate history.
Old history.
Yeah, were any of you guys there?
No. Thanks for picking us.
So yeah, I was like,
two panels in, are we on the panel?
I'm the only person who really spent a couple minutes for you.
Yeah, but, so yeah, there's like, so it's definitely...
Diesel punk, so we wanted to talk a little bit about how it's not speech punk.
Yeah, oh god, it is, guys, it is not steampunk.
Did anyone go to the panel on diesel punk fashion in no, I don't. So the thing about Dieselpunk that is really I don't know if you guys are, if any of you here are into Dieselpunk, but it's a really cool thing. But it's also rooted in a lot of like problematic themes. Like a lot of Dieselpunk is rooted strongly in World War II aesthetic. And a pre-World War Art Deco aesthetic. And what happens in a lot of like Dieselpunk communities is that there's an element of Nazism. Maybe not intentional, but there's a lot of like celebrating Nazi militant fashion and so forth. And I think like even though George Miller, I don't think Dieselpunk as a term was really something that he would have been aware of at the time. Like obviously Road Warrior, like the whole Mad Max franchise is Dieselpunk. It's rooted in a dependency on oil and a dependency on gasoline. And like obviously like by Fury Road, like everything, the only thing that's left is metal. Like all the cars are metal, but also like the cars are elements of destruction. And so like really what he does over the work of the franchise is to take the like the World War components of Dieselpunk and break them down and show how harmful they are. Which I think is really, really interesting. Because it's not just punk versus metal. It's look how metal punk is killing us in a way. So I think it's really, really interesting.
I'm also interested in the contrast between filming something like on the scale of Fury Road, where it's diesel punk in the sense that he actually built all those giant friggin' cars, which is awesome as a film goer, like a filming technique, but then you sort of have like what are the environmental impacts in a franchise that's very focused on sort of the slow destruction of the environment of actually building the new Warriors, like, three-story rig.
I was just going to say that, like, Matt Miller is such an environmentalist. Like, Happy Feet is, like, the most environmental movie ever. it's so interesting to me that he basically ransacked the desert of Namibia to make this film. Yes, Ms. Peggy?
The world that it's in clearly plays a very big role for each and every one of the characters and the story itself. I mean, you look at the Citadel, and it's the only location with any bit of green. We talked about George Miller not wanting a blade of grass anywhere, but there, he's got water, he's got plants, there's grass growing. They seem to have like a fully functional little world there. And then you step outside of the Citadel, and it's a complete wasteland. It's rusted out. It's leftover oil refineries being used for gasoline. Bullet factory is turned into a town for their source of ammo. And of course the interesting characters that come out of each of those towns too. But it definitely, in my opinion, plays a huge role not only as a backdrop for those characters, but as a character itself, because as you go from location to location, the terrain and the territory actually shapes the groups of people that are living in those areas.
Are you
talking
about the still people?
What's it?
It's like 4 seconds on the screen.
Scary, did you just think that was like a throwback to the Dark Crystal? It's a pretty Dark Crystal. I was like, oh my god. Sexes is kind of the deal with the Wheelers to return to Oz. Yeah, they were the thing. Yeah. Yes, Striders. Lance Striders. Thank you.
I'm like, Lance Striders. I saw the Wheelers a little bit, like, from Return to Oz. But then what's amazing is, like, put so much detail into that, it's, like, on screen for, like, a second. And then it's over, and you're like, what was that? And you're like,
he said in an interview that those Landstrider things were actually men on stilts.
Yeah.
That they were actually like men on stilts trying to get the last of what they could from that land.
Yeah, he said they were meant to survive on crows and whatever stagnant, revolting swamp water that they could get their hands on. And a lot of the different environments just kind of show the end result of this whole diesel pump world where it is inherently non-renewable. This is what happens when you run out of these things, and this is how it shapes the way that you live your life. I mean, the Bubalini talk about how everything they have is with them right now, and anyone else who they encounter, they just kill rather than having to deal with the possibility that it could be a danger versus being a friend.
Does anybody remember at the end of Road Warrior where they're going, like where the group of people is going?
they want to go to the city.
They wanted to go to what was essentially like a version of the Green Place. Like it was a city 2,000 miles away, where there was water and fresh food, like just like plenty. Like I don't know if they identified it, but it was basically a version of the Green Place. And the idea at End of Road Warrior is that they were going to this place. It was there, and they would get there. Like there was never any indication that it wasn't there. I mean, obviously 2,000 miles, a lot can happen, but it was a positive movement.
And well, then they ended up somewhere.
And then, of course, by Fury Road, what happens? They start going to this place across the desert, 2,000 miles, and there's nothing there. Like, they pass the Green Place, but there is no more Green Place. So it's a really, really staunch, like, there is nothing on the other side of that 2,000 miles.
I was going to say, I really like the environment as sort of a reflection of Max's mental state. As we go from, he has a family, things are like slowly breaking down, but there's greenery and stuff in the first Mad Max, and it slowly devolves, and then like he's in literal pig shit in the Thunderdome, and it's like...
He stops having pets at a certain point.
Right, and by...
Like, I'm done with loving things.
Right, by Fury Road, he's like flashing back constantly, and I think there's also like a sort of element, yeah, with Furiosa, where she identifies like the green space, yeah, is this sort of mythical area. It's a character because it's just this ideal that she holds in her heart, but
who knows if it was even that great.
Right, yeah, like it could have been anything.
Yes. Feminist movie, so they hate all men, why not? Well, that's also an echo of what, was it Brian Azzarello did to Wonder Woman? Like, he retconned the Amazons so that they actually did have boy sons. They just took them off the island and killed them all. So I think that's maybe like an urban myth that gets rolled around whenever you have something that's too feminist to handle.
Water of a hose and dropping a hose and letting it spill everywhere is kind of like you just have to accept the mystery of this movie is about excess and there's going to be a lot of car crashes. It doesn't matter how many cars they use up. It doesn't matter how many bullets. It doesn't matter how much gas it takes. They're going to get the wives back.
Right. And it's very
nice. I always thought it was a lot. It's like that's sort of like the fundamental contradiction of a movie about car crashes. Also about a world where, you know, gas is incredibly scarce, but I think Jordan Miller is a lot more concerned with telling that scarcity story visually versus practically. So yeah. Bullet Town would be cool. Bullet Town might like build a bunch of bullets and that's all they do, but Bullet Town also is like sort of symbolic for all the things that the society is holding over everything else. Like they only give a shit about bullets. They want to fight, that kind of thing.
shows just this is what they prioritize in this world. And from an economic standpoint, they do have, and Gordon Joe has his greenhouse and he has his water, but that's shown as being a very kind of oligarchic thing. So if there is water, if there is greenery, that's something under the control of very few people. You don't have greenery town or anything like that, because that having access to that is a symbol of power. You have the drones and the grunts kind of producing bullets and sacrificing themselves and dying historic. So on one hand, it's a class thing very much, I think. And on the other, I think it's just a matter of how much of this physically is there. Maybe it's easier to just infinitely continue producing bullets and gasoline until you run out versus trying to cultivate whatever three remaining trees you still have.
And it's all allegorical too. So it's all basically a reflection of our own society and our addiction to industry. And because of course all of this is killing them. Like they're all tumorous, all cancerous. This is not sustainable if only for the reason that they are killing themselves doing this.
Yeah, the kids are being used up in the same way that bullets and gas, like teenage boys are dying.
Yes.
And it's all seen as totally normal, like if you sacrifice yourself, that's great.
Well, this also plays into this idea of scarcity or excess, this waste, because basically any culture, especially in the cultures of climate change or crisis, those in power will often act in an excessive way and waste valuable materials to prove their place of power. Like the scene where Gordon Joe opens the water floodgates and has it spilling down onto bare rock, and all of us are sitting there, everybody who's thought about these things is like, that is the stupidest way to distribute water ever.
Well, it's not about distributing water, it's about, it's a power, it's a power grab.
Unless you think unless only you want water.
Rusty. So I know they were trying to get that blue sky it was apparently a real nightmare with the bright desert and the blue sky and shooting digitally and trying to open up to expose the actors but also not create noise in the digital image. I think it's one of the best looking digitally shot films I've ever seen. They used anamorphic lenses. And then they, in the grading process, they actually tried to make the Alexa footage look shittier so that it would match the 5D and the RE more. I can see the 5D footage is really obvious. I'm like, oh my god, that's like a home digital camera. But I think aesthetically, in the editing process, it works. It's done in the midst of stunts that you couldn't get if you had to rack a big expensive camera. And I'm personally glad they didn't shoot it 3D, but I did watch both the 3D print and the 2D version. I think the 2D version is actually better because you can see the undercranking more. And the undercranking is shooting a slower frame rate, and then you speed it up to normal speed, so it's got a jittery effect, what they call fast motion. People usually use it for comedy reasons, but I think George Miller is actually kind of an expert in using fast motion for non-comedy effect, and a huge portion of the film is actually sped up, which is why there's so much dubbing and so little dialogue, which I also think was great. There's so little dialogue because it's a very pure cinema experience. I don't think you need to even really be able to speak English to mostly get it. So he's a personal hero of mine, just, you know, outside of this panel, and he's one of my favorite filmmakers for kind of muscularity, like use of push-ins and high speed, which it kind of reminds me of like Dick Lester, which I know people have sort of complex feelings about, but I love his early stuff. And he reminds me a little bit of like Fellini, it's like the Terry Gilliam stuff, especially with Thunderdome, but that was a co-director. I'm trying to stop talking about camera sources that don't match. And apparently the DP said, John Steele said that he didn't even care about like the lenses matching, like whether the color came in the same, as long as they were like ish in focus.
And I believe totally, didn't his wife also kind of provide a set of eyes and say, okay, so this is an action movie and here's what I think about it as a woman? Basically.
And I really wonder about, because of the comics, what we know about the Furiosa comic now. I really wonder how much of what we got in this miraculous feminist movie was because of the editing.
Also, Eve Ensler,
Vagina Monologues, came in to do, I mean, because I'm sure you all know there was no script. It was a fake script that was written just to make Warner Brothers happy, but it was apparently garbage. The film is a series of storyboards, but then they were also constantly making up new shots on the day, and nobody on the crew really knew what was going on. So it sort of came together as a story in the editing room, but Eve Ensler came to sort of improvise with the actors and help them come up with backstories and come up with quite a lot of the dialogue.
Right, she worked
She
worked with the wives. She
tried to give them background information because she's worked pretty extensively with victims of sexual trauma, and just to try and let them know this is what a psychological mark, the kind of psychological mark that would leave on you, and here are ways that it might manifest in these characters. But the actors themselves were given a lot of free rein with how they wanted that to manifest, and the actor who plays Cheeto talks about how she's basically been Stockholm syndromed into thinking that she's better off in the Imogen Joe's world because it's all she's known, and possibly she hasn't been as she hasn't been sexually abused by the Imogen Joe yet.
I heard they get to choose their wardrobe as well.
Yeah, they did. They just took them into a room with a lot of white sheets laid out and said, all right, make yourself an outfit that you think best represents your character. And that was pretty much
how they came up
with their own aesthetics.
Yeah.
And they also, I don't remember if this was Rosie Huntington-Whiteley's choice, but Egg Harris self-mutilates as a way of damaging Imogen Joe's property.
Yeah, that was her, that was part of her backstory that she came up with.
And they incorporated it.
Yeah, and they also, for the record, despite how like horrifying a lot of us found Furiosa's comic, which we'll talk about. we keep saying we'll talk about it.
We should talk about it now.
We should, but Charlize Theron did know about that backstory. I don't know if she came up with it, but she knew about it because she mentioned it briefly in some interviews before the film came out.
I think in a lot of ways, giving that kind of backstory in a comic is really overwrought because I think it was portrayed so well in the film. It's pretty obvious that these kind of abuses and trauma are haunting these characters. Even Furiosa, like knowing the specific, like to the living sexual nature of like a trauma is really not adding anything to a character.
So does anybody not know what? Sorry, before we get too deep into this, does anybody not know what?
Yeah, does everybody know about the Furiosa comic?
Okay, so the Furiosa comic basically added context to the wives' backstory. In fact, most of the comic called Furiosa is focused on the wives while they're still under Morgan Joe's care. And the way that, George Miller is listed as a writer on the comic, but more importantly, the main storyboard artists are the writers on the comic. And it has really undergone a lot of really frustrated critical reviews from feminists and fans of the movie because a lot of what it does is take agency away from the wives and gives it to Morgan Joe. The comic starts out saying, oh, well, his mistake was giving them education. What the hell? Because, it sort of reframes the wives' agency as coming from a Morgan Joe because he generously educated them.
Right, and he's the one who provides them with Furiosa.
Yeah. Yes, he generally gave them the history woman to teach them things, and she was the one who instilled in them a desire for freedom. You couldn't have a desire for freedom on your own. You couldn't have a desire for freedom. And also, one of the storyboard artists who wrote the comic responded after criticism of the comic came out, and he said something awful, which was that he said this on Twitter. He basically said, oh, well, they wouldn't have wanted to escape so much unless we basically sexually showed them being sexually assaulted over and over. They were kept in a sealed vault, you fucking asshole. What the hell?
So,
of course they would want to get out of it.
One of the real, points of this is obviously there was rape happening in Fury Road.
Right.
But George Miller, unlike the most ridiculous rape scene in Road Warrior, chose to pretty much imply these things. It's very obvious to the audience what's going on, but then the comic book takes this backstory and makes it super explicit, which
they're
not very respectful.
There are scenes where, the women are afraid. The classic, ooh, a guy looking at a woman through the V of her legs, how sexually, provocative that image is. We see that in this comic, only she's about to basically be, it's implied that she's about to be raped at that point by two guys who are fighting over her. And it's just extremely unnecessary. Because obviously there's a problematic history of women, women's rape being shown for titillating purposes and being shown to make them weaker and make the male audience feel sorry for them.
And going along with that, it kind of erases a lot of the interesting choices that they made in Fury Road, which was to portray these women who are beautiful and sex slaves without actually showing any of that specific abuse happening on screen. But instead showing how it affects them psychologically and how it informs the choices they're making.
Yeah.
So a lot of the pushback against the comic has been because it kind of undoes those really interesting and progressive choices about these women are portrayed.
And it doesn't do it just to the wives, it also does it to Furiosa, because the name of the comic is Furiosa. Essentially, she does this really horrible thing where she slaps Splendid, because Splendid wants to abort her baby. And then she tells them they're crazy for wanting to, she basically implies that once was a wife of Morton Joe. Yeah, and that he kicked her out of the vault when she was unable to bear children. And the implication here is that if she had been valuable, at the time she didn't think she was valuable because she couldn't bear children, and at the time she wanted to stay because she felt protected. And these aren't things that we are, projecting. This is what they actually put in the comic because they thought that it would make her character more complex.
I don't think that's what the thought process there was. I think a lot of when you watch the movie, it's a pretty political movie.
We have to reconcile this comic with the movie.
Do we need to reconcile it with all of the floating continuity, or can you just say,
it's
fantasy. I hate it, so it's dead to me. I mean, to me, what I love about Furiosa in the movie is here's this woman. She's obviously disabled, but she's really fucking good at her job, and so she's been given this top-level position. We don't know how she climbed the ranks, but I always get the sense it was like from captive to grunt to like grease monkey to driving the war rig.
And it has nothing to do with a woman's work.
I can't even imagine her ever being a wife. Like, that doesn't even make sense to me. Like, the change in relationship between Mort and Joe, seeing her as a wife, and then suddenly seeing her as an employee, I can't even buy.
Right, and like the whole point, I mean, we are not things, the sort of idea that...
Why did he put her in charge of them?
Right, he obviously has some trust in his deputies because he lets her make a run by herself, but clearly he doesn't see his wives as even worthy of that kind of respect. So it's a weird backstory. To me, I don't particularly consider it canon, especially with the free-floating timelines of the Mad Max stories. If you consider it, I feel like it's very unnecessary.
And honestly, if you want to look at it from within that world, you can see it as maybe a story that was spun by some of Imogen Joe's supporters about how he was such a good husband, and he gave them knowledge, and they ran with him because he gave them the power.
And this comic also starts with a frame story of somebody telling a story. So, just like everything else, it's somebody's version.
Did you have a comment that you wanted to make in the back? You.
She made it so great. Literally, I was even just saying to them, I was like, that's exactly what I was going to say. Like, that's how I saw it. And it bothers me that it becomes... I'm sorry, I lost my tool voice. It bothers me it becomes like this whole like feminist issue because it's a woman leader. I don't think that should be an issue.
So, like, you don't think the film should be a feminist issue? No, or just the fact that she
is, that people are making a big deal of
that she's making a big
when
deal
it's just an amazing
deal.
Character.
She's an amazing character.
I think there are two sides to that, because on one hand, a lot of feminist media critics are looking for characters like Furiosa. That's the sort of character that they really want to see more of. So she becomes like emblematic of media that we want more of. So things like this comic are sort of like, no, that's the opposite of what we were saying we wanted. And on the other hand, yeah, you can appreciate her totally as an amazing character, but I think it's really hard to sort of take it out of context of the conversation that's been happening about media.
It's hard to separate her from the reality of what women experience, so seeing a woman like her on screen is so rare that it's really hard not to see it as feminist just because of the rarity of it and the lack of representation.
And it bothers me that it's so rare.
Yes.
And I think,
has anyone read the other two comics, the one with Nux's backstory or Mort and Joe?
I don't remember anything about the Nux's backstory. But
going to what you were saying about, we keep talking about the floating timelines and the storytelling and the telephone between characters. I read the Nux and Mort and Joe ones, and the continuity is not there either. And I truly think that we can treat, at least I did, the comics as supporters of Mort and Joe, war boys telling the story of their individual idols out of context with the timeline, but from their point of view.
Right, it's just continuing that folk culture of people telling stories about how they see it or about how this particular person wants to spin that narrative so that it swings in their favor. And it's much more preferable than just considering it all straight up canon. Cool, in my opinion.
What's your point?
Aside from that one scene where they're washing themselves, they're really not shown with like longing pants going up and down their bodies or anything. Yeah, and you can even look at that. Well, in that scene though, the focus is on the water because you're seeing it from Max's perspective, and he's not like, yes, these hot women are washing themselves with water. He's like, yes, there's water, and these people are in my way, and I want the water. So it's a very interesting way they did it.
The framing of that is so like classical painting too. There's some really interesting art criticism if you look on Tumblr about that specific
yeah, scene. It's not filmed for the male gaze at all. It's filmed in this way. It's filmed in a revelatory way, but it's like water, not ooh, hot girls.
But it's very interesting because it sort of reframes like mythical stories about women being like discovered as sort of nymphs or virgins because they're explicit in that way. So.
Yeah. I think in general, over the course that since Max lost his wife, he has not been a very sexual character, and I feel like none of the films have really been framed around romance or sexuality. I feel like he'll vibe with people, but it's not really like it's not about that. So yeah. So but even if there's like some subtext that you can draw out of it, it's just never going to lead there. So like the camera work, you know, it's still a male gaze, but it's not aggressively focused on that.
Minutes, I believe. We are the last panel in this room tonight, so we can maybe go a little bit.
Yeah, we'll see.
Well, like, we'll see.
We'll try and cram everybody in the last 5 minutes. So you and then.
So going back to comics for a second, I think what's interesting is we see two different of the history keepers, the people with the words on them. In the movie, we have Miss Gibb, and she has the words on her, and she's obviously the history keeper who is in charge of educating the wives. The person that we see framing the story in the comics is male. They have a male district keeper telling the story. And I think right there is your difference. The person who tells the story about the woman is a man. And he is putting a very pro-male spin on some pretty horrific things that have happened.
Right, and wouldn't it have been interesting if it had been Miss Giddy narrating the whole thing after all? Even if it was just
and it's also male. All the comic writers were males, so that's the frame storytellers, and then inside of that, more frame storytellers, and then the story.
Okay, so next question.
Fly the way they did when they came out 15 years ago.
I think aging. Like, George Miller's like, what, 70, 75 now? Right. And he's made Happy Feet and Babe and Pig in the City. In the meantime, he's got grown kids, I think. I'm not sure. I think he's mellowed and matured. I think he's got different things that he wants to talk about now. I think some of that rage is probably mellowed and probably channeled.
Yeah. I feel like Fury Road is really a culmination of everything that he's learned about how to tell these stories, where he doesn't have to just have like some 5-minute rape just happen on screen, because there are better ways, there are more interesting ways to show that, because that's sort of a scene that we've seen in so many other movies, including his own, that like Fury Road to me, for him, is really like this elevation of all of the things that he's wanted to talk about, but in the most distilled way he can do it. Like, especially with the lack of dialogue, there is like a lot of color theory happening, like all of that kind of stuff.
Well, it's very subtle. There are a lot of things that are kind of implied and gotten across without needing to be explicitly spelled out, and I think that translates very, very well. And you realize that you don't need to have things portrayed explicitly in order to pick up on them. And I think that's something that could potentially set the tone for future action movies. Realizing you don't need to have all of these.
John Wick.
Maybe you don't need to have all of these things played out from this perspective to this extent. Maybe there are other aspects you could be focusing on. Like Wile E. Coyote in the Roadrunner.
Well, he gets himself back in Fury Road.
Well, he actually, this is Jack back, right? He wanted it. His car, his never gets the car back. Or is his one
oh, it'll come back in the next film.
In medias race. In media race, like in the middle, we never ever see like exposition in the Mad Max films, ever. It's always just, yep, here are the characters, here's what they're fighting for, let's go, cars. And like, I think that that's really important, because that way, the fact that Max loses things is never, they're important to the plot, because those things motivate him, but they're not important to our understanding of him as a character. Like, we don't grieve for him that he's lost, like, everything that he owns, because we've seen him do it 18 times, and he always gets it back in the end. Like, I think that those things are, like, the movies are motivated more by what drives him while he's on the road and he has nothing. But actually, like, what those artifacts are, we aren't as attached to the artifacts as we are as to, like, his struggle to get them back.
Can I add to that? I'm going to disagree with you. I think the reason Max leaves is because that's what a homophobe character does, that's what the man with no name does, that's what you do in a Western. You roll in and you leave, and I think you are pretty attached to his struggle to survive, but because he's such a subsistence level character, like...
He can't fit into society.
Right.
He's got to... He can't stay.
So the listing of things gives him a reason to keep on moving and redoing these cycles.
Right,
and I think it's very significant that he holds on to his name until the very end, and only kind of gives it up when Furiosa is so out
We have two more points that I really want to hit. And one is like diversity and disability. We actually just talk about both of them together, I think, because they're pretty fluid. But
this is my favorite.
Yeah, it's 11:03. Thank you guys for hanging out with us. You've all been a great audience.
Also, guys, there is supposedly a cosplay meetup tomorrow. I don't know if anyone knows where it is for Fury Road for Mad Max in general. If anybody finds out about it, please let one of us know. If you need any of our Twitter handles, please ask.
Okay, 11:00 in the Hilton.
Okay, so for all of you in cosplay, we're gonna share that with everybody. Appreciate the info there.
Awesome. Yeah, if you guys want to move into the center, we can squeeze down.
Hi, everybody.
Yes, thank you guys. You're awesome on
it.
So, disability.
Is it a wonder to us?
Kat wrote an essay about disability, and I know she wants to talk about it throughout the series. Thank you.
I think disability is definitely one of the motifs that happens a lot in Mad Max. It's another repeating thing, and when I wrote this, I wrote an essay, but I actually got a commenter that said it's much more commonly depicted in Australian media, and I can't speak to that, because for me it's very striking to see so many disabled protagonists, main characters that are very visibly disabled, and starting with when, with Max himself, he's mad, and in the first movie he's very angry, and it sort of turns into like a psychosis. And his knee brace as being like a particular identifier of who he is, like it's, even if it's just a retelling legend, like it's definitely a key part of his character. But then you move beyond that, and in Road Warrior, you have the mechanic and the sling, which I think is probably one of my favorite depictions of disability in Mad Max, because it's very, it's not subtle because there's a crane that's swinging him around, but like it's never mentioned. He's totally capable of going on this ludicrous car ride to escape. Everybody is totally fine with it. Like these things, like because he's such a visual storyteller, disability is pretty much entirely expressed like in these visible ways.
And yet the feral kid is essentially not verbal.
Right.
It's never really stigmatized either. I mean, and part that might not necessarily be as progressive as it seems, because this is a world where everybody is screwed up in some way. But I do think that it's an equalizing agent too. And
what I love about it is that it doesn't just assume that disabled people disappear from the world after the apocalypse happens, like which happens a lot, especially in like zombie media. Like, oh, they can't run, so they are dead. Which isn't really how communities or society works. Like disabled people have always been around, will probably keep kicking around, you can get a super fast wheelchair or whatever, like you can probably escape. And I love that it becomes a really embedded reality in all the different worlds of Mad Max. And I think it also, I mean, it's not perfect obviously, because there's George Miller and Fury Road sort of falls into different tropes of like the sort of grotesque disability versus, and a lot of that is like reliance, like sort of beauty standards in the storytelling, where obviously the wives are getting pure and virginal, so they're also very beautiful. Their image isn't distorted, and Martin Joe is very like intentionally grotesque.
It is noteworthy though that that people with disabilities are not just portrayed as villains.
Right.
I mean, yes, it is maybe a little bit heavily focused on characters who are pretty villainous, but it's not solely focused on them either.
And he uses them also in a way to continue telling a story. The bullet farmer has some kind of like elephantitis or gout, which is very like like this disease of excess. So he's using them as metaphors sometimes, and that like that's kind of.
Yeah, because he was the one that started out about how much fuel it
cost.
Is that people eater?
The people eater,
excuse me. But actually, Bullet Farmer is blinded in the film.
The Bullet Farmer, but the people eater is also the one, again, he has a false nose, which could also be attributed to syphilis or some other kind of disease of excessive indulgence in one way or another.
Right, so you have like that layer, and I really like, Corpus Colossus, the callback to Master Blaster, where Max won't kill a man and he didn't know like such an interesting story because like he's a full character, like he's a character before you know anything about that. And it's sort of like this deliberate perspective shift. And like Master is treated as a totally competent villain, even though he's like very disabled. But he's very much an equal in this power struggle with Anti-Entity, and not just because he has like he's riding around and dudes who can kill dudes, right? But like they're not disrespected for his disabilities.
Right. Yeah. Did you have a
Yeah, I just wanted to get Alan's opinion on why Anti-Entity lets Max live at the end of Thunderdome.
Because they're the same.
Yeah, because she realizes that they're equals, and I think she realizes, you know, they're but for the grace of going goodbye, or, you know, the kind of two sides of the same coin.
We're a pair unit. Who does the line exactly? I was screwed.
Ain't we a pair?
Ain't we a pair?
Yeah. I think she kind of wants to see, you know, what happens.
She wants to rebuild. She wants to rebuild Bartertown, and I think for her, like she's not interested in pursuing enmity at the expense of being able to rebuild her community. And I think like once she sees how like that he is like someone who unites, like ultimately unites rather than like destroys, I think that she can forgive like the anarchy that he brought to her town, at least like temporarily. Like I don't if he goes back there, you know, you don't know what happened, but I think.
I think she knows you won't. He's a drifter. Like she feels like she really understands the core of his character. Right. Yeah.
She's gonna want to use him again.
Right.
I
mean, exactly.
I think in a lot of ways, she doesn't want him dead because she knows that at some point down the road, if he reappears,
yeah.
She can make use of him yet again.
Right.
You know, she needs that trump card to you know, have him kill.
And I think she thinks it's fun.
Yeah.
She's very playful.
She gets a little pleasure out of it.
Yes.
Yeah, who do you guys think slang articles?
Oh, it's slang. It's what the dad says. I believe it's supposed to refer to, like, I think it means, like, vermin, like in the first scene where you see him squashing a scorpion or a lizard and picking it up and eating it. So she says she has a slang. The dad's the one who speaks a lot of very Mad Max slang.
Yeah, yeah.
So she says, he's a filthy smeg to be schlanger.
I think it's penis.
It's like a lizard, right?
But I believe, I read so somewhere, I don't remember where, but I don't think it was a fan theory. I think it was in the face that it means lizard, or it means whatever comes his way. But it could be, it means
I thought it was dead.
I know.
And speaking of the wise, we wanted to touch a little bit on diversity because there was a lot of talk about, there's a lot of criticism that Mad Max didn't have enough characters of color. And that, what representation was there was tokenized, and I think that's a little, it gets us into a really interesting debate about colorism, essentially, because a lot of, two of the wives, and one of them, Valkyrie, in the film, actually are, obviously Toasted's are played by Zoe Kravitz, and, the actress who plays Cheeto,
Courtney.
Yeah, I'm getting mixed up. The actress who plays Cheeto and the actress who plays Valkyrie both have Maori descent, and Cheeto is actually Chinese Maori, and then he's an islander, I think. So I think that, but the thing is that those actresses aren't necessarily visible, and it, of course people are confused.
That's
the question. Is this an issue? Are we assuming? Is our assumption that these characters are white? Are we the problem?
Okay, your assumption of those characters. I think it's interesting to sort of view this because it's an Australian film, so the idea of race is different conceptually than how we view it in America, and I've read a lot of meta on this, where, those with, Maori descent is considered, if you have any background, you're Maori, you're part of the group, so those women would be recognizable as part of this group to an Australian or New Zealander areas where there are more Maori people as people of color, as other talk about that without saying that these women are not people of color, like, are bad representation in some way because they're light-skinned, so.
Right, and it's describing certain viewpoints, like a more American viewpoint of race and ethnicity, and trying to describe those same values to Australian society, where if you say that you have a race, that's all that matters, because you can have that descent and look like pretty much literally anything. And it also just brings into, there has been some discussion that there could be more Aboriginal Australians cast.
Yeah, and there's one for like a millisecond in the film.
Right, pretty much the only one you see is there for a split second and then gone, and there are a couple of darker skinned poor boys who are obviously covered in white paint, and I believe the one that took Warrior is a bit darker skinned, but I could not say.
But that's a visibility issue, so it doesn't
right,
count
there
as
also
visible.
Obscure the entire time. So, but I think just to say that these women are so white casting that they don't count as a more damaging viewpoint,
right.
When you should be approaching it with a more of a growth mindset and saying, okay, so we have these women who are of color, but instead of saying that if they're not good enough, disregard them, say we need this and we need to expand
more.
This and
yeah.
More.
Yes.
So let's open it up.
Right, we should have darker skin wise. There should be more people with darker skin, like pretty much any race or nationality. But like I could definitely, like there is room for another black character. Like you didn't just have tons of Kravitz. And I think that's totally a fair criticism, but I don't think it's appropriate to discount that ethnicity of other actresses.
And just compare it to, again, I'm sorry, but just again, compare it to previous Mad Max movies. I mean, it's a step in the right direction, and hopefully, again, other action movies and movies in general will take that cue from it, and I know Fast and the Furious.
Yeah. No, well, yeah, I was just going to say, that's what makes Anti-Anti-G so great, though, because she's like this amazing, powerful black woman in an action movie that, like, is not a genre that... Right, like it's for Tina Turner.
But you have to wonder as a wanderer if he goes, towns tend to group together sometimes, and if you, hopefully as a road warrior, we will see him in other locations with future films where there will be a greater diversity found. Because we got to think about location. If it is truly set in Australia, unlike Europe and in America, there might be, it might be more realistic to say that there's not as much diversity. However, we know that the world is very mixed, and so I would hope in the future films that we would see, as we get into new locations, a lot like Bartertown, that there would be a much broader diversity there. I mean, we know that some of the war boys were, but unfortunately, we got about 20, 30 seconds of them and really not a lot of talk, and then it just disappeared, so there really wasn't anything to elaborate there.
Plus, I'm not super concerned with realism in terms of racial quota in a movie, pretty much any movie, but definitely a movie like Mad Max.
Yeah.
And it's like people who try and argue about the makeup of Hogwarts is exactly like the makeup of the racial makeup of Britain. But if it's a world where you have giants and wizards and all of that tomfoolery, then fuck around with the racial dynamics and the percentages and whatever. It doesn't hold on.
And I wanna ask my final question to the panel, which is, based on everything that we've just been talking about, what do you guys want to see for the future? But first, what do you want to see?
Oh, sorry, I was going to say, as far as Australia goes, the third most common last name in the Sydney phone book is
definitely. Yeah. There's a lot of representation that's lost there.
Is this even Australia at this point? For me, it's kind of like a Middle Earth situation. Like, he's now taken the long way. And he's now walked off the map into, infinity desert.
Yeah, there's that speculation about that, too, about how it can't actually be Australia, because he says you could ride for however much time through the Salt Flats and still never get anywhere. And people are like, well, Australia's not that big. So, clearly, maybe we have a new, Kent Day thing going on.
Exactly.
Oh, my God. No, I'm actually going to be terrified by that thought.
Again, we're not working with the Australia we know in terms of race, ethnicity, or even geography. George Miller doesn't know when this takes place. So.
That blew my mind. Yeah,
well, that's exactly what I was thinking. Like, Salt Flats at the time, I was like, that's the ocean, yes, in the back. You, yes.
We have to talk about those cars.
We've not talked about the cars.
Man, they were so floating.
The main characters.
Yeah, the cars are definitely characters.
I love how much the war rig is for Furiosa. Yeah. Like,
and I love the callback to Rogue Warrior too.
Yeah.
How much the war rig is just like, or just the rig in general is so like.
Man, I'm just gonna keep this gun in a skull that I punched me into.
But also the fact that Furiosa
is also
the fact that it's a Maltese Falcon. Do you guys write? Because in the Road Warrior, it's full of sand. In Fury Road, it's full of nothing. it's a decoy. It's basically like it's their survival. Like their survival hinges on this thing that's being used as a giant decoy that represents everything that they're really trying to destroy, which I think is awesome.
I love how she set up the rig for only she can drive. She's the only one that knew the sequence. It's not only really intelligent, but if you look, it shows intentional free planning on Furiosa's part, and it was just really enjoyable to see that. And it looks like we're...
Yeah, we have had such a great time. So I guess we will... Yeah, thank you guys so much for staying.